I guess I have one of the most interesting talks today because I think as an investor, one of the most difficult things to figure out is what to invest in. There's over 2,500 stocks on the Australian share market alone. So to try and research all of them can be quite difficult to do. And I remember when I started out in the market, the advice I got was go with the names that you know and trust. I thought, well, I'm out of uni and, you know, I like my wine. I'm drinking quite a bit of it, and I was at the time. And I thought, well, I'm going to buy into a wine company. I'm contributing in terms of profitability to a wine company. And so my very first investment was $500, which is a minimum investment, into a company called South Corp, which made wine. Well, a month later, I had doubled my money. That $500 had become $1,000. And I thought, you know what, this is pretty easy. I'm going to give it another shot. And then I thought a little bit more deeply about it. And I thought, actually, you know, I don't want my shares to go south like in the name of South Corp. I want them to go north. And there was a company at the time called North Limited. And I thought, that's a great idea. I'll put my $1,000 into North Limited and hopefully the shares will go north. Well, North Limited got taken over by a company called WMC, and a month later, my $1,000 was now $2,000. So I thought, you know, third time lucky, I'm going to give it another shot. So I'm looking through all the names of the ASX listed companies, and I come across one called Julia Mines. Now, my name is Julia, and I thought, this is a sign. I am going to put my money into Julia Mines. And I put my $2,000 into Julia Mines, and this was during the tech boom. Julia Mines suddenly became Julia Limited, a technology company, and I doubled my money once again. And I guess since then, I've become really interested in trying to figure out what it is that moves share prices and how to make money on the market. And one of my hobbies is looking at the market and filtering the market, but also reading academic studies that have been done on markets around the globe. And I know that there are certain things that give investors an edge in the market. I know that companies with earnings momentum, so growth in earnings, they tend to outperform the market over time. I also know that for the technical analysts there, companies with share price momentum also tends to outperform the market over time. I know there's also been studies done on both earnings and price momentum. So by combining the two and having both earnings momentum, so earnings growing, as well as price momentum, the share price rising, you get a much stronger effect and you're more likely to make money in your portfolio. Also know that in terms of small caps, well, they're likely to have a small cap effect and should grow faster than large caps. So all these things, I guess, combine to try and figure out what it is that makes stocks move and what stocks do well in your portfolio. So I guess my presentation is stocks to watch. Obviously, I don't know each and every single one of your circumstances, so please have a look in light of your own circumstances. So I do mention specific stocks, and please have a look to see whether they would be right for your circumstances. But for anyone who wants to have a little bit of a sleep, I thought I'd make it easy and just put all the stocks up in the beginning. So in terms of mining, my picks would be Rio Tinto, Sandfire. In the lithium space, if I had to pick one, it would be Mineral Resources, as well as BHP Billiton for a diversified play. In terms of yield, this is Smart Group as well as AFI. For those of you who want more of a passive type of investment and don't want to do so much work. And in terms of growth, Lovisa in the retail space, Afterpay also in the retail tech space, Altium, corporate travel, and the stocks in an upgrade cycle, 80 Milk, Costa Group, Mineral Resources, Treasury Wine Estates. But really, while my presentation is called Stocks to Watch, what I wanted to do was to leave you with some thoughts and some tools that you could use in your own portfolio to make stock decisions. And I guess when I'm looking at the market in 2018, I'm looking at it in two different areas. The first is in terms of growth. And in terms of growth, the picture still looks pretty good. At the moment, we're seeing synchronized global growth, even though there is a threat of a trade war at the moment. We are seeing the strongest growth rate for global growth that we've seen in around about 7 years. We're also seeing corporate earnings growing, both here in Australia as well as the US. So in terms of growth, things are looking pretty rosy. I also look at the market in terms of liquidity, and this is where a lot of the volatility has come from in 2018. And I think this is one for investors to watch, especially investors who are looking for an income stream from some of their stock investments. So in terms of liquidity, I'm really just watching what's happening in the bond market. The bond market is amazing in that some of these cycles in the bond market, they tend to last a whole career. And the last bull market that we've seen in bonds has lasted around about 36 years. So that's massive. And so the fact that that seems to be coming to an end and we're at an inflection point is causing some volatility in markets. But altogether, I'm very positive in 2018. I think there is going to be a bit more volatility this year. So there's going to be a little bit more up and down movement compared to 2017 and 2016, where we saw extremely low levels of volatility. But I think that throws up an opportunity as well. So I really do think that we're late cycle. And what we are going to see is energy prices and things like commodities outperforming in 2018 with a little bit more volatility. Now, just having a look at the macro backdrop. So I guess when you're looking at the market and looking at growth, there's a macro factor, things that are impacting on the economy, and then there are the micro factors, things that are impacting on the individual companies. But having a look at a backdrop in terms of a larger cycle, this is the S&P 500 from 1930 to the current time. So it's an extremely long-term chart. You can see that there are some boxes in red and there are some boxes in green. The boxes in red are where the market has tended to move sideways or even down during that period. And then the boxes in green are the ones where the market has tended to move higher over time. So the red boxes are called secular bear markets, and then the green boxes are called secular bull markets. We have a lot of animal terms in terms of the market and jargon. Every industry has jargon. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the animals of the market, we have the bull, the bear, and we have a cat as well. I'm a cat lover, but I'll quickly run through. Because I've mentioned bear and bull, bears have claws and they tend to claw down things. So a bear market is one where prices are being clawed down. They tend to be falling. Bulls, on the other hand, have horns, and they tend to throw things up in the air. So a bull market is one where prices are being thrown up in the air. Now, there's also the dead cat bounce. I'm a lover of cats, so please don't hold it against me, but a dead cat bounce is where, I've never tried to bounce a dead cat, but apparently what happens is it bounced a little bit, but it's dead, so it comes back down to earth. So a dead cat bounce is one where prices look like they're going up, but then come back down to earth. So there you have your three animals of the market. But coming back to long-term market cycles, and the black swan. black swan, you know, is in Perth, and it's very unusual to find, but you know, a black swan, you can't really see it coming, so it's a little bit harder to predict. So we have long-term market cycles, and the last box there is a green box. Look, these cycles tend to last around about 14 to 18 years. So in terms of the cycle that we're in at the moment, we're in a bull market cycle, but we're in the late stages. Why is that important? That's important because we can go back in history and have a look at what type of investments tend to perform well late in a bull market cycle. So would you be curious as to know what tends to perform well? Well, late cycle investments, this is where inflation is starting to come through. And as inflation starts to come through, well, growth looks relatively strong. Commodities is something that's reliant on that growth and that global growth coming through. So commodities tends to perform well as inflation comes through and that growth comes through late cycle. Energy also is one of the best performers late cycle. So oil prices have been performing quite well over the last couple of years, as you would expect, and I'm overweight energy coming into 2018. Other sectors that tend to perform well, typically these tend to be more defensive areas. We start to see a bit of a shift into some of the defensive sectors of the market, like healthcare, utilities, and staples. And the reason why we call these areas defensive is because people spend money on healthcare, utilities, and staples is things like Coles and Woolworths, our groceries, even if the economy is bad or good. So they tend to be defensive type of cash flows. You tend to see these cash flows relatively stable throughout cycles. Now, in terms of healthcare, utilities and staples, I'm okay with healthcare, but I'm a little bit more cautious in terms of the utility sector because of what's happening in the bond market. Sectors like the utilities, the property and the telecom sector have done extremely well since the global financial crisis. And a large part of that valuation is because of the very low interest rates that we've seen around the globe. As those interest rates start to rise, the valuations of some of these companies are going to fall, not because of what's happening in the company, but simply because of what's happening in terms of interest rates. These sectors, these companies, they tend to have large amounts of debt because of their stable cash flows. And of course, the cost of that debt is going to be rising. So as the cycle turns, these investments, they tend to be falling. And we've already seen that. Anyone who owns Sydney Airports, Transurban, Telstra would know that we have seen the share prices coming under pressure over the last 6 months, as we've seen bond yields around the globe rising over the last 6 months. So for income investors, that's something to be careful about. But for Australian investors, it's really commodities driving growth. This financial year, we're predicted to see around about 7% earnings growth. But if you have a look at the banks and the industrial sectors, they're only forecast to grow at around about 2%. So the growth for the Australian share market is coming from the commodities space. Look, the strong rebound in profits that we're seeing is probably mainly baked into share prices, but we're going to get bouts of volatility in 2018, as we're seeing now, and I think that's an opportunity to get back into some of these commodity stocks. Strangely, dividend growth remains quite strong as well. I think that most things in life moves in cycles, and I think that a lot of industries move in cycles as well. Commodities is certainly one that moves in cycles, and it's one that's tied to the growth cycle. So as long as the outlook for global growth is strong, you should see commodity-based stocks doing well. As soon as you're seeing concerns around global growth, well, you'll start to see a bit of a backward step and share prices falling. Of course, the second derivative of that is mining services companies. So mining services companies tend to follow that commodities price cycle, but a step later. So as commodity and resource companies get stronger cash flows, they're more likely to spend those cash flows, and mining services companies benefit. And really, I think the inflection point or the turning point for the mining services cycle came last year in February. So that February reporting season is where I became very positive about mining services companies. And not so much because they were seeing great profit growth, because they weren't, but the outlook statements were a lot more positive. So that cycle turned in February and I became really excited last year, because I know that when a cycle turns, that a commodity cycle tends to be a multi-year cycle, and a mining services cycle tends to be a multi-year cycle. So I've been riding this cycle for around about 12 months and it's been doing well. So there's stocks like CIMIC, Downer EDI and Monadelphous, which have performed very well over the last 52 weeks. So in terms of mining picks, look, what we're seeing in China is they're clamping down on pollution, and that means in terms of mining companies, where I want exposure is to higher quality product. And we're seeing that especially in terms of the iron ore markets, where the higher quality product is selling, and this is in terms of iron ore, Vale, BHP or Rio Tinto's product. Fortescue has a lower quality product, and so it's becoming harder for them to shift this product as China focuses in on cutting pollution and they're going with the higher quality product that's better for the environment. So I would avoid probably Fortescue, and I would prefer to go with BHP and Rio Tinto. I like BHP Billiton because it also has that oil exposure, and you know that I'm positive oil in the late cycle, the late part of the bull market. There's a possibility for BHP to also sell its shale gas assets over in the US, so the possibility of a capital return to shareholders in this type of environment I think would be a positive catalyst for the shares. And Sandfire, copper, debt-free, strong cash flow. Copper, they say, is the only commodity with a PhD in economics. And they say it's got a PhD in economics because it tends to be a predictor of economic growth. If you see copper rising, it's generally because global growth is rising. And if you see copper falling, it's generally because global growth is, or the outlook for global growth is falling. Mineral resources is a little bit of a different one. Its earnings is driven by lithium, which is part of that battery story. Now, I think the easy money in lithium has been made. And I say that because when you are investing in anything, I think that at some point there's a really strong demand response, and it, especially in terms of commodities where demand's very strong and you see prices rising. But it's not that hard to find most commodities. They say that Australia is the best digger of dirt in the world. It just takes a bit of time for a mine to be set up and to get your head around the processing and the technology part of it. But at some point, there's a supply response because prices are rising. And for me, when I look at investing in commodities, it's when you get that large supply response that for me is a warning sign that perhaps the market is balancing. So in terms of lithium, last year was a fantastic year for lithium stocks. But earlier this year, we heard an announcement from SQM, which is one of the largest producers of lithium in the world, in Chile, and it's also one of the lowest costs. And it came out with an announcement that it would look at increasing production by as much as 4 times. Now, in 2018, they're forecast to be producing about 63,000 tonnes of lithium. By 2024, they expect this to be 163,000 tonnes of lithium. So that, to me, is a signal that perhaps it's time to look at getting out some of my lithium exposure. I'm still very positive about lithium, but for me, the easy money has been made and you're seeing a strong supply response. And at some point, I think that that tells me that there's probably risks, that there's going to be a bit more downside in terms of share price and a little bit more volatility, and it's going to be more difficult to make money in that area. But if I had to pick a lithium stock, it would be mineral resources. Yield is a little bit more difficult, and I think one of the features of this reporting season is that in terms of the blue chip companies, it was really difficult for a lot of income investors, people who look for those dividends to help support their lifestyle. And it was difficult because in the top 20 stocks, we saw 2 major dividend cuts. Telstra cut its dividend, that was well flagged. But we also saw QBE Insurance cutting its dividend substantially. This time last year, QBE Insurance was paying a 33-cent dividend. This year, it paid a 4-cent dividend. That's a huge cut. And I think the real lesson came that if you don't see that earnings growth to help drive the stability in dividends, then it's not unusual to see big dividend cuts like this. So for income investors, it's not only about the dividend yield and perhaps the franking credits, but it's also about the stability of the dividend, and that really needs to be underpinned by earnings growth. So in terms of yield, I'm a little bit more cautious in terms of some of those high yielding stocks because of what we're seeing in the bond markets. And so I would prefer to sacrifice some of that yield for growth. So these companies still have yields between about 3 to 4% on an unfranked basis, but the earnings growth is quite strong. Smart Group grew its earnings by 32%. It's still forecast to grow once again. They've done a capital raising because business is strong and they're reinvesting in growth initiatives, but they've still got a strong dividend yield as well. For people who don't want to do their own investing, one of the options is AFI. Now, this is a listed investment company. And while a lot of income companies or income trusts which are focused in on producing income, they're very focused in on some of the blue chips in the markets like the Big Four banks, Telstra, the QBE insurances of the world. The reason why I like AFI here, because in the top 20 investments, which you can have a look at in the announcements of any company, includes growth options like Macquarie. So it's a little bit different from your traditional top 20 investments from a typical income-based company. And that's why I've included that one in the mix for income. But the problem for income investors is this graph here. This is a long-term graph, 1968 to 2018. This is the 30-year Treasury bond yield. So bond prices go opposite to yields. You can see that big peak in 1981. Since then, interest rates have basically been falling. They've been falling. And over the last 12 months, right at the end of that chart, we've seen a reversal in that trend. And the fear is that this 36-year-old trend that we've seen has now reversed, and we're going to see the opposite for a number of decades, and that's a rising interest rate environment. And that, of course, is going to impact on valuations of any asset around the globe. So this is a problem for income investors at the moment. This massive bull market that we've seen in bond prices, and so bond yields have been falling, is looking like it's reversing, and that's causing volatility in all asset classes around the globe. So that's why I'm really quite wary on being overweight income, especially those typical bond proxies like Sydney Airports, Transurban, Telstra, the utility sector. These areas, we're seeing some of that froth coming out simply because of what's happening in terms of the bond market. Comes to one of my favourite topics, and that's reporting season. When you're an analyst in the market, Christmas comes twice a year. Half-year reporting season in February and the full-year reporting season in August. And look, for me, it's important because it helps me to identify those companies that might be extremely profitable for me over the next 5 to 6 months. Reporting season is important because there's been a number of different studies that have been done around the Australian reporting season, and companies that beat what the market expects, beat the consensus in terms of earnings during reporting season, not only tend to outperform 3 weeks after they've released their reports, but even 5 months down the track, they tend to be outperforming the market. Companies that have not only beat expectations in terms of their financial reports, but also have had a strong price response. So their price performance, the share price performance, has also beat the market. There's an even stronger effect. So they have stronger performance as a group after 3 weeks and even 5 months down the track. Now, knowing that information, would you be pretty excited about reporting season? Because you get to try and identify those companies that are going to outperform perhaps over the next 3 weeks as well as the next 5 months. But sometimes during a reporting season, it can also get a little bit confusing. Has anyone found that a company comes out with a record profit, revenue's grown by 100% and profit has grown by 100% and the share price falls? Has anyone? And then you're scratching your head thinking, what's happened? Or the opposite. You buy a great business, a good quality business, a very strong business, and the share price doesn't move for years. It's extremely frustrating. And for so long, I've tried to figure out what it is that moves share prices. And I often think about it like buying a business. Let's say I'm going to buy my local corner store, and I call my local corner store the inconvenience store because it charges double what I'd pay at the supermarket. But let's say I was going to buy this corner store, and you know, this corner store, it's been growing at 10% for the last 10 years, and it'll probably grow at 10% for the next 10 years. Very, very stable growth. And I pay $2 million for this corner store. I try running the corner store. I do it for a few weeks. I decide that, you know, this is not the business for me. I've changed my mind. I want to sell the corner store. Now, nothing has changed. It still has grown at 10%, and it'll probably still grow at 10%. How much do you think I'd be able to sell the corner store for? A lot more than $2 million? Probably not. A lot less than $2 million? Probably not. Around about $2 million? Probably yes, because nothing much has changed. But what about in that time if, you know, the council zoning rules had changed in that area, and instead of just houses, you could have apartments being built in that area? Suddenly when I went to sell that corner store, could I sell it for more than $2 million? Yes, because there's been a new piece of information, and that new piece of information has been a positive catalyst for the valuation of that business, because that corner store will probably see growth of more than 10% every year coming into the future as more people move into the area. And the same with stocks. You could buy the best business in the world, but if nothing much changes, then should the value of the business really change? It should remain relatively stable and not do too much. Or you could buy an absolute basket case of the business and find it's the best performer in your portfolio. Why? Because all the negative news has been priced in, and then slowly you start to see relatively positive information being priced in. So in the case of that company that came out with a record profit, 100% revenue growth, 100% profit growth, what if the market had been expecting to see 200% revenue growth, 200% profit growth, and that company came out to say, we've had a record profit and we've grown our revenue and our profit by 100%. What do you think the value of that business will do to adjust to that new information? Will the share price adjust up or adjust down? It will adjust down because the market prices in new information. It prices in new information. So it's very important to know what the market consensus is or what the market thinks the profit is going to be, because it's all about beating that number or underperforming against that number. So the market is all about pricing in new information. And that's why sometimes you can get the best stocks in the world not moving for a number of years, or the worst stocks in the world being the best performer in your portfolio, because it's about the new information that's incorporated into the share price. So coming into reporting season, this is the February half-year reporting season. The three best performers and the three worst performers. The best performers, A2 Milk, it was up 50% in the month of February. Altium was up 28% in the month of February, and corporate travel was up 22% in the month of February. But you know, A2 Milk in the 52 weeks had been up 467%. Given those numbers, who would be happy buying A2 Milk? There's a few brave souls in the room. What about Altium? You know, up 28% in the month of February, it had already increased 150% in the last 52 weeks. Who would be buying Altium? A few less hands. What about corporate travel? Up 22% for the month, 52 weeks, up 43%. How many people would be comfortable buying corporate travel? So there's not a lot of hands in the room. What about WiseTech, IPH and Myer? WiseTech, you know, down 33% for the month, IPH down 33% for the month, and Myer down 23% for the month. Anyone comfortable in buying any of those three stocks? A few more hands in the room. It's funny, the psychology of investors. Sometimes when shares have fallen 33%, people think, oh, I'm getting a bargain. But remember what I told you? Companies that tend to outperform during reporting season in terms of not only their earnings reports, but also in terms of price, they tend to outperform as a group 5 weeks down the track, as 3 weeks down the track, as well as 5 months down the track. And that's why reporting season is important. So if it was me, the stocks that I would be interested in researching further would be A2 Milk, Altium and Corporate Travel, rather than WiseTech, IPH and Myer. And that's because I know what happens after reporting season. Shall we go back in time and have a look at what's happened past reporting seasons? Let's go back to last year, February's reporting season and the August reporting season. So let's go back and have a look at February 2017. So we're going back in time here. And back in February 2017, the three best performers were Seven Group, which was up 40% for the month, but had risen 121% in the 52 weeks. St. Barbara Mines, which is up 22% for the month, but had risen 63%. Monadelphous, which had been up 22%, but had risen 90% in the last 52 weeks. And I remember doing a presentation around February reporting season back in 2017, talking about these stocks and asking for a show of hands on who would be interested in buying Seven Group, St. Barbara, and Monadelphous. And I remember maybe two or three hands went up, because people get nervous when they see these big share price reactions. Now, I'm not saying that these companies always go up, but as a group, there's a higher probability that they're in an upgrade cycle and that the share price will be well supported. So for me, I can't research 2,500 companies, but I can have a look at some of the best performers and then research them further to see whether I think they are in an upgrade cycle and earnings are going to be continue to be driven upwards, and hence the share price also be driven upwards as well. I want to find that cycle, because it's easier to make money when companies are in this positive news cycle rather than a negative news cycle. So let's have a look at these three companies. Are you interested in having a look at how these companies performed from February 2017 to the next reporting season, let's say till September 2017? Now remember, They don't go up 100% of the time. You still have to do your research. For example, St. Barbara Mines is a gold company, so that would be reliant on the underlying gold price. But just to give you an idea, here's February to September. First one was Monadelphous from February to September. Not a bad looking chart. I think it moved from about $10 to $7 to $12 in that time and is trading even higher now. So a company that's been in an upgrade cycle, very much a mining services company, and earnings have continued to be upgraded since then. St. Barbara Mines is a little bit different because it is a gold company, so it is reliant on what's happening in the gold price, but still not a bad result. A lot of up and down movements and sideways, but still ended up higher in September compared to February. And then the last one was Monadelphous. Great looking chart there. It was about $10 in February and it was about $15 in September and it's continued onwards and upwards. So you can see that people are very nervous when they see big stock price movements. But the question that investors should really be asking is, why is that share price moving so strongly? Is it because that company is in an upgrade cycle and are earnings likely to continue to be upgraded? I know that when a company enters into an upgrade cycle, this is a cycle that's likely to last many years. And I've learned that in the past because I've bought stocks like A2 Milk at 49 and a half cents, only to sell out thinking I'm doing extremely well, having doubled my money, and then only have to get in and out again because it is in an upgrade cycle and the share price continues to rise. Would you like to have a look at the August reporting season? Anyone interested yet? Mineral Resources was the best performer, up 28% for the month, up 167%. Abacus Property up 22%. A2 Milk up 20% for the month, up 178% for the year. Now, with these, you also have to have a look at what's happening behind the scenes. For example, Mineral Resources, we saw SQM coming out in around about January to announce that it's going to increase production in the lithium space, so that impacted on all lithium miners. And Abacus Property is in the property space. And with what's happening in terms of bond yields, we saw a taper tantrum, or we saw bond yields rising quite significantly in December, and that impacted on the property sector, the utility sector, the telecom sector, Sydney airports and Transurban. So you still have to do your research and find out what are the key drivers. But let's have a look. First one, Mineral Resources. Even with the volatility that we saw, it moved from about $13 to $19 around that time, even though it had already had a very strong performance in the year. Abacus Property is a little bit different because of the temper tantrum, and you can see exactly the impact that higher bond yields had on the share price of Abacus Property, other property trusts in December, January, as well as things like Sydney Airport's Transurban. If you overlay these charts, you would have seen the same type of looking chart. A2 Milk, this one blew it out of the water. I think just before its result in August, it was trading below $5. It's currently trading above $12 in a very short period of time. So given what you've seen the last two reporting seasons, would you look at these companies a little bit differently now? So this is February 2018. A2 Milk, Altium, Corporate Travel, three companies that are in an upgrade cycle. I like to ride the upgrade cycle until I see that it's at an end, and then I'll jump out. WiseTech, IPH and Maya though, IPH and Maya definitely probably stuck in a downgrade cycle. And look, at some point, these stocks that move downwards can be extremely profitable. And that's when the cycle turns. But the lovely thing about the share market is that you can be 100% correct and still lose money. And that's because trying to time when that cycle turns is the difficult part. For most of these companies, at some point, that cycle will turn. But is it 6 months down the track, or is it 2.5 years down the track? Companies like Fletcher Building came out with a profit downgrade last year in April, came out with a profit downgrade last year in June, came out with a profit downgrade last year in November, and then came out with another profit downgrade this year in February. So these down cycles also tend to be multi-year cycles. And while there are some gems that do turn and you do see a violent move upwards into an upward cycle, and stocks like Qantas as well as BlueScope Steel over the last few years come to mind, it's much more difficult trying to pick out of those stocks that are losing and when that cycle is going to turn than just riding a up cycle that's already in play. So having a look at this reporting season, we have certainly seen a number of companies still stuck in that downgrade cycle that looked relatively cheap coming into this reporting season, continuing to fall. And often when you see broker reports, it says, don't like this company, but it's a buy on a valuation basis. That is, that it's looking very cheap. But unfortunately, often cheap continues to fall because if it's in a downward cycle, a downward earnings cycle, you start to see revisions downward. And Meyer, an example of that, it was down 24% in February, it was down 60% for the year. Now in the last 52 weeks, it's down more than 80%, so it's continued to fall further. Focus down 21% for the month, for the year down 50%. Look, it's been falling for a couple of years, Focus. Fletcher Building, as I mentioned, as another example, down 15% for the month, down 32% for the year, but once again, stuck in that downward cycle for a couple of years. And Domino's down 13% for the month, down 25% for the year, and it's been stuck in that downward cycle as well. So I guess the cheap continues to fall. And expensive continues to rise. A2 Milk, Altium, Nine Entertainment, NextDC. These are all companies that have increased 100% over the last 52 weeks that continue to see earnings momentum come through. So these are companies that are likely to continue to be well supported, driven by that increase in earnings. So really when it comes to reporting season, I'm trying to identify those companies that are stuck in a positive news cycle, a positive earnings cycle, and hence positive share price cycle. I'm trying to avoid those companies stuck in a downward cycle. And look, I don't try and time when that cycle is going to turn because it's very difficult to time it. And it's absolutely true that you can be 100% correct and still lose money in terms of the market. So some of the themes. Look, this year we are going to see some strong global growth coming through. We are in the latter stages of a bull market, and we know that in the later stages we get more volatility. So you are going to see much more up and down movement than we saw last year or in 2016. But for investors that know what's happening, this represents an opportunity. So when you see those dips, that's the opportunity to come in and buy at cheaper prices. Because we are in the later cycle, what you are going to see is people trying to time when that cycle turns. And I think we still have 18 to 24 months left in this cycle, but remember the market price is in new information. So come the second half of this year, I think we're going to see a lot more talk around that cycle turning. And that's going to lead to a little bit less dampening in terms of the enthusiasm of the market. But for the moment, we're in the late cycle, and we know what investments tend to perform well late cycle. Energy, commodities, healthcare, these are the sectors that tend to outperform. But we will see more volatility, so watch what's happening in terms of the bond market, as well as the outlook for global growth.